सेकेंड। सो यू हैव टू जस्ट वन सेकेंड, फिर भी एक चैट का मुझे देखना है। रिद्धि चैट मैसेज कर मुझे।
बहुत कुछ पूछना है
चैट किया तूने? आया नहीं मुझे। क्या दिखा रहा है उस पे? दिख रहा है चैट?
हां रिकॉर्डिंग स्टार्ट कर रहा है।
हां
बोलना।
उसको एडमिट किया क्या मैंने? आपने? मैंने किया। हाँ किया ना। मैं अनम्यूट पे हूँ क्या रिद्धि?
Hello everyone. If you're facing any issue related to sound or connectivity, please write it in the comment box below. We shall be starting a session soon as you're waiting for some of the participants to join the session. Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you all are doing safe and good today. I'm Riti Karadia, your host for today's webinar. The topic for the webinar is service continuity during emergencies. Would you first like to introduce my company, QNX? QNX is a management consultancy firm having experience of more than 25 years. With 350 plus satisfied clients present in 19 plus countries. QNX is a CMI Institute partner organization with 250 plus CMI appraisals. Also, in 2016, we were among 10 top partners in CMI Institute, USA for a new appraisal. Now, I'm glad to introduce my presenter, Mr. Yogesh Deshpande. Mr. Yogesh Deshpande is a principal consultant with QNX Infotech Private Limited. With more than 25 years of experience, hands-on experience on different types of roles in the delivery and the quality control, and also been a leader in the implementation of ISO CMI Six Sigma as a manager as well as a consultant. Also, I would like you to all write your queries in the comment box. We shall then take up in the question and answer session at the end of today's webinar. Now, I would like to request Mr. Yogesh to take over the session. Thank you.
Hello, good afternoon all of you. So thank you very much all the participants for joining for this today's session on service continuity during the emergencies. Okay, so before going on to the core topic, let me first bring you to let me first introduce you to what actually the service is like, actually, because there are some participants who are actually coming from a non-service background. So for them, I would like to start with some brief about what is the service. So service is something which actually is like it is an action which is being generated. It can be traded, bought or sold, and it has to be consumed. Okay. So the service is like actually something which is produced somewhere and it is supposed to be consumed. And the typical characteristics of this service are like it is intangible, that it cannot be seen. Unlike a product, it cannot be seen, touched or felt. It is inseparable. That is, it has to be consumed wherever it is produced. You cannot generate it somewhere and consume it somewhere else. It is perishable in the sense it has to be consumed when it is produced. You cannot generate it and preserve it somewhere and consume it at some point of time. Okay, and you have to it is variable. It has got a variability, that is, no two persons can have the same kind of service getting generated. So even if you train all the people who are going to be working on that service, you cannot have the same kind of service being generated by two different people, and the ownership cannot be transferred. So typically, the service includes something related to education, consulting, transportation, entertainment, media, infrastructure, including water, electricity, sewerage, even the internet connectivity that we all are using for attending this session. This also is a service. So all these services actually is what actually we are going to talk about today. Now, let me first tell you like what exactly there would be some exceptions to what typically a service is. So sometimes the service is not a pure service. So in case if you are going to a restaurant, actually, so it is a combination of food plus service. Or even when you are traveling by air, that time also you get the food along with the air travel that you do. Then whatever products that you purchase, that includes the product and the preventive maintenance or any kind of maintenance service that is required to be as a deliverable. Even cars, hospitals, the same kind of thing is applicable. Now, this is about what a service is typically. Now here, I would like to emphasize like why actually we are talking about services today. And why actually we are thinking about even service continuity during the emergencies. So before that, let us first understand what is the contribution of services in our total world GDP. So you look at this. If you look at this chart that I have shared, here you can see that there is a distribution of how the share of services versus manufacturing, how these two sectors are contributing to the overall GDP of the world. So if you consider the world GDP is not shrinking. It is always growing and it has never stopped growing. So in that, if you see the manufacturing sector, so manufacturing sector is showing a downward trend. So it's a very gradual trend that it is showing. But if you watch it carefully, you would realize that this trend is moving from 30%, around 30%, it is coming down to around 25% of the total GDP. So that is the percentage in percentage terms. And the blue line is the services contribution. So the services sector is moving from 60% to 65%. So it is like 2/3 of the total GDP is contributed by the service industry. Now, the very obvious reason for this service industry to grow is that there are a lot of products which have been introduced in the market every day. But the overall durability of these products have increased. So what happens is that the product is getting sold once, but it is getting serviced multiple times. So you might have got your bike or a scooter or a car. When you purchased it, actually the deal happens only once, but over a lifetime of that product, it will get serviced or it will get serviced for at least 100 to 200 times. So that is the reason why this service industry is growing. Plus, in addition to that, there are a lot of other factors also. I will tell you like what all other factors are contributing to this higher share of service industry or the service sector. So I would like to show you one map, global map is there. So here you can see the data that we have is about the percentage, the countries having the percentages in the total GDP. So if you consider that there are a few countries who have got around 70%, more than 70% of their GDP generated through services sector. And these countries are USA, Brazil, Australia, and the Western Europe. So these are the countries who are the leaders in the service sector. And there are other countries who are following up. Even if you consider India over here, India is having around 50% of its GDP coming from the services sector. Okay, let me show you how actually it contributes to that. So I have got another chart for you. Now you look at this trend chart again. Now here again the blue line is the service sector and the orange line is the manufacturing sector. In this, the trend is very much visible. The percentage of GDP over a period of time since 2008 till 2017, that is the data which is available now, you can see the trend of service sector is growing upwards. So from 45%, so if you look at this trend, actually it has moved from 45% to around 50%. And maybe by 2020, it must have definitely crossed 50-55%. And manufacturing has got reduced from around 32% to around 26%. Now, why this is happening? Now, even you know, we all know that Indian economy is not shrinking. Okay, the Indian economy is growing, and so is even the manufacturing sector. So, in spite of Indian economy growing, and even the manufacturing sector is growing, but the percentage of the growth in the percentage terms comparatively with the service sector, you can see that there is a decline over here. So here, what we have to interpret this chart is that the growth in the service sector is comparatively much higher, and that is why the percentage wise growth of service sector is high. So India is also showing the same trend what the global trend is. In fact, India is showing a sharp trend. So that is what I wanted to explain it. Now, if you look at this is the map that I would like to show. Here, if you see, that some of the states in India who are leaders in the percentage wise GDP of the states. So the leaders in this this list is Maharashtra is there, Maharashtra, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, and West Bengal. These are the states which are actually on the upward trend, which are having the service sector as a major contributor, and the other districts are following up. This is just an indication about how the service sector is growing. Now, if you consider this, now you can understand that how India, Indian service sector is growing and how the global service sector is growing. Now, in this entire thing, what is happening is that service sector is gaining lot of traction, and because of that, the service continuity has become a key word for the industry. Now, when you say a key word, now let me show you something what actually has happened in the service sector in the recent few years. I would like to just show you how the service sector is evolving. So the next one, next slide, which I am showing you right now, this is about how the evolution is happening in the service industry. So if you look at it, that these are the kind of blocks actually. So this service is kind of, you can imagine that it is an application software service is there, wherein the application is being made available to the users. For that, for every service, there are different components which form this entire service. So if you look at these service components, it has got networking, storage, servers, operating system, middleware, data, applications, a lot of such components form this service. So when actually you look at this, the earliest trend, which used to be like 35 years ago, it used to be like everything used to be on premises. Gradually, the trend changed, and then they said, like, okay, why do we do all these things at our end? Let us outsource some of the things. So some of the specialized, some of the generalized things were outsourced. These were like actually the level one components, you can see, which are at the bottom. In infrastructure as a service, you can see that some of these components, which are in orange, they are being outsourced. And the blue ones are those components which are managed in-house. So there are some components which are being outsourced and some components which are being insourced or managed internally. Now here in platform as a service, it is further, the specialization is further generalized. So the organization in platform as a service is only focusing on the application and the data, and rest of the components are being managed by others. So this is another trend, and going forward, there are some very generalized softwares which are available. So these softwares are totally managed by a third party. So that is called as software as a service, in which you just pay for the subscription, and you pay for the subscription charges, and everything else, including your data, would be managed over there. So that is called as a multi-tenancy kind of a solution. Now this is going to be the trend going forward. So more and more that we are actually getting specialized in our business areas, actually you don't want to perform, you don't want people to do all the things in-house. So these are getting outsourced, and the service sector is growing in this way. So you are focusing more on your business, and there are a lot of specialized services which are getting outsourced. And the reason why actually we are discussing this is because the service industry is evolving, and so are we supposed to evolve. Now here, you have to understand how the industry is behaving, and accordingly, you have to change your strategy also. So if you change your strategy, then accordingly you will be able to sustain with the changes in the industry. Now even if you are managing some of these applications, so you know what all components that you are supposed to manage, and what all components that you are going to outsource. So even if you are outsourcing it, you know what to expect from the service continuity. And if you are managing it in-house, you know what are the things that are required to manage it in-house for the service continuity. These are some of the examples of the infrastructure as a service, that is IaaS, it's Amazon Web Service, Cisco Meta Cloud, Microsoft Azure. These are the companies, these are the products actually that they have, companies are their products that they have. Then you have got a platform as a service through AWS, Elastic Beanstalk, Microsoft Azure is again over here in a platform as a service as well. Even IBM Cloud is there. And for software as a service, there are a lot of options which are available now. You have got Jira, which is a project management tool, Dropbox, Salesforce, and even this meeting which is happening now on Zoom. This Zoom meeting is also a kind of a software as a service, wherein you don't have to do anything in-house. Everything is managed by the software vendor. Or that vendor who is managing everything, including your data and all the application. And you just have to pay for the subscription. So these are the kind of changes which are happening in the service industry. So those who have joined in late, I would like to inform them that please write down your queries in the chat. And we will try to take these queries possibly at the end of the session. So first, we will focus on completion of this session because a lot of people are interested to understand this topic. And anybody who has got any questions so far in this session, please write down your queries. We will be happy to answer those queries. Thank you. Okay, to continue further, now, yeah, there are typically in services, we can have multiple nature of services. So these are the three main nature of services. So some of the services are like one-time services. The one-time service is you complete that, you plan that service, you execute that service, and then it's over. You don't have to do anything after that. Typically, it includes something like education, training, coaching, consulting. So these are the kind of one-time services. Like this session itself, which we are having, this is also a type one-time kind of a service. So once this is complete, there is no further follow-up or there is no part of it which is going to be continued. So this is also one of the type of service. Then there are some on-demand services. The on-demand services are like you have to pay for the subscription and you avail those services. So for the product support or doctors or lawyers, these are the kind of services that you do it on-demand. And then once it is done, even that actually doesn't have any kind of a further plan. And the third type is continuous or uninterrupted service. So this is the focus area. Now, what is this? This is the continuous or uninterrupted services. The examples are like the data services, electricity, water supply, and internet connectivity. Again, I would like to remind you that our session, which we are having today now, is happening through internet. So all those who are able to see this listen to this session today, we are all connected through this internet connectivity. Even I am also using that service, because of which I am able to speak to you. So these are the continuous or uninterrupted services, which is the key area. Now these are the key areas which are very much in focus, and where actually the service industry is looking at these sectors in the uninterrupted services. Now here, I would like to show you So for any kind of a service, what is required, what is the strategy that is required for that service to be available continuously? So there are typically two types of strategies which are there. One is that you have a substitution. So whatever services that you have, those services you need to have for the services or the service components, you need to have a substitution for that. So in case a power failure is there, the power is a service component. So in case if there is a power failure, UPS or inverter or a genset can be the backup for that, or a substitution for that. When any machine tool fails, the hand tools can be the substitution for that. So anything which is like not like original, but something alternative option is there. So that is called as a substitution for the main service component. Whereas in most of the other cases, we have the backups. So typically a backup is, we generally use it like the human service. Suppose if a team member is there who is responsible for performing any activity, normally we plan for a backup resource. So that is also service continuity. So whenever we say that we have got some of the team members, we always plan for the backup team members. And so is the case with any machine, instrument, or any server or any such device which is being used for the service delivery. We always plan for the backup of that. So in some cases, it is like the strategy is like N plus one or N plus N. Now here, I would like to give you one example. N stands for the number. So if you consider that you have got five team members who are performing a typical kind of an activity, and for that you have got one extra resource. So five are the normal team members or the resources that you have planned for, and one of them is a backup. So the strategy which is being applied for backup is going to be N plus one. So here what will happen is that you may have additional resource. So in case if one of the team member is unavailable to provide the service, the backup person will take it up. Whereas N plus N is for every resource that you have one equivalent you will have one equivalent resource which is available, and who would be able to back up in case of the main resource failure. So these are the kind of strategies that are applied for the backups. Now here you have to understand that if the scale is big, so in case of N plus one, if the number of N is more, then you would have the cost is going to be less. But for in case you don't have the number N higher, for each number, if you are going to have a backup, the cost is going to be higher. And that is how you have to decide the strategy for that. And for the strategy implementation, you need to have the budget for that. For every substitution or backup, you need to have a budget for that alternative source. And for deployment and testing is also necessary, because what may happen is that you may have all the strategy identified, but if you have not deployed that strategy and you have not tested it before deploying it, then it is of no good use. So that is another thing that you need to plan for. Now, let us first understand what is a service continuity. Okay. Now, typically people consider service continuity and disaster recovery as synonymous terms. But there is a basic difference between the disaster recovery and the service continuity. So typically those who are coming from the process background, they understand what is risk? Okay, so risk management is identifying and mitigating that risk. Okay, so before that risk actually occurs. If the risk occurs, then the risk management strategy has failed. So in the same way, service continuity is a preventive activity or a prevention activity. What may happen, that is being anticipated and a strategy has been created to avoid that from happening. Whereas in disaster recovery, you know that there is going to be some kind of a disruption which is expected. But what you plan to do is that it's not fully avoidable or it is not feasible to have a service continuity strategy for each and every component. So in that case, you may go for a disaster recovery. So what is a disaster recovery? Disaster recovery, as it is depicted here, it is kind of a firefighting. Now there is a fire and you are trying to control it. So that is disaster recovery. Whereas in service continuity, you see to it that whatever strategy that you have implemented, it will prevent that disaster from occurring, or it will prevent that disruption from occurring. So disaster recovery is actually a subset of business continuity or a service continuity plan. And on that, actually, it is the downtime, as we know, in any case, in service continuity and for the disaster recovery, the downtime is going to be expensive for the business. The reason is that the customer, the time is being lost for the business opportunity is also lost when actually we are working on that strategy. And it is very difficult to implement the service recovery without any disaster recovery. So it is important for us to understand where it is possible to identify which components are required to undergo disaster recovery strategy and which components are supposed to undergo service continuity planning. So typically the disasters which happen in the service industry are typically the equipment failure, machine failure. Sometimes there are some natural calamities like flooding, tsunami. In case of there some uncontrollable factors which are like fire in the structure building. Then there are sometimes there are cases where there is earthquake, there are climatic situations like hurricane, tornado, cyclone. Then there are human factors which can be impacting the business, that is theft, corruption, damage, or virus. So all these actually, and many more, these are a few of the examples just for our understanding of this discussion. Now, coming to the next stage, that is the service continuity. So as you can see, the service continuity is about the prevention. It's not about what to do after that event or after that disaster has happened. It is about how to prevent it from occurring. So here in service continuity, there needs to be an action plan for the business continuity during the distress. So there would be situation, but we have to make sure that the business continues or the service is not impacted. Now here, what is important is that not each and every service can be put under the service continuity plan. So we have to identify the critical services, those services without which the business will get impacted. So that you have to identify. And there should be a strategy which needs to be implemented for these critical services. There should be a minimum time which should be lost, or there should be no time which should be lost ideally. And again, here also in service continuity, what is important is that the strategy should be tested. Okay, without testing, it's of no use. You may have the best of the strategy, but if you don't know if it is going to work, then it is of no use. For example, if I'm taking a backup, Okay, so I am implementing a strategy. I am taking my data backup on the cloud platform. So on Google Drive or any other source, I am taking the backup of my my laptop. And one fine day, when I am supposed to, when I am expected to restore it, then I realize that this backup is not restorable. So this strategy, which I have implemented, is of no use if I am not going to test it. So testing is very important. Whatever you implement it, you have to test it. And there are, these are the advantages of service continuity. It guarantees that there will be a regular business during these disaster situations. So whatever you have planned for, if it happens, you would have some level of guarantee. There would be the downtime can be avoided completely, or there would be a very quick recovery. The cost will not be much at that point of time because you have invested. There are two things. One is when the disaster happens, that time you spend and you recover. And the other one is you spend in advance in anticipation that if it fails, it should not impact. So you are actually investing. So the cost impact is less when it happens. And of course, whenever there is a service continuity, even during all these situations, it builds a customer confidence. And it builds a business reputation also. It develops a business reputation. So coming to the next stage, that is, what is the service continuity planning? So now, so far, what we have discussed is what is a service, why these services are important, how the services are growing, how the services are evolving. We have seen a lot of such things. We have seen what is a service continuity also, that what actually we need to do for the service to continue and service to be available when it is required. Now here we are going to see what are the stages of this service continuity planning. So this is a six step service continuity planning. I will explain it in detail in the subsequent slides. So the first stage is disaster planning. So disaster planning is, you have to consider that these services are very important. And from these important services, which are the critical services? Critical services are those services. If those services are not available, then the continuity would get impacted. The business continuity would get impacted. First, you have to identify these critical services. And second is to identify the service components which form these services. So like we saw one example previously, that for an application service, there are some hardware, software, operating system, data, middleware, servers. All these things are the components, service components. So these service components form the service. Service components together form the service. So first identify the critical services and the critical service components and the respective threats and vulnerabilities to these critical services. So you first identify that these are the things which are likely to fail, which are susceptible, and you identify what are their vulnerabilities. Then the next stage is you perform the business impact analysis. So you identify that if we consider these as critical services, what will be the business impact on that? If some service is not available, if the network is not available, then what will happen? In a banking kind of an application, if the network is slow, what may happen is that the transaction would not get through. What happens typically is if I am standing in a at an ATM and I am trying to withdraw money from that ATM, if the service is very slow, then what will happen is that the network service is very slow. What will happen is that the transaction will not get through. It will get timed out, because if it doesn't get completed within some stipulated time, then the transaction will be cancelled. So I'll not be able to withdraw that money, which is mine, from the bank ATM. Now, this is the business impact that we have to understand. So if I am a customer of a bank, I would say that the bank's systems are not reliable. So that is a business impact for that bank. And the business impact has to be identified, and if these services are not available. So here, the next stage is about the service continuity management. So service continuity management is, you have to identify the client's requirements and expectations. So if you are working for a client, or if you are working for clients, there you have to understand the client's requirements and expectations. Identify what is the organization strategy. Sometimes the organization has got a service strategy for continuity. So in some areas it is good. Some areas they are very particular about having a very strict service continuity strategy. You have to understand the cost of that service continuity versus the business loss. You have to do a cost benefit analysis and get a budget for that. So that is a service continuity management. And then the planning part of it, service continuity planning part of it. So for planning, you have to get the core team identified for that. You have to identify the team members who are responsible for this service continuity planning. Identify the overall objective for that service provision. And then you have to identify the micro level strategy, whatever the details are required for that maintenance of each and every component. So you have to go into the details of each and every service and say that if this service or if this component is not available, what is required to be done for restoration of this component and all. And you have to identify the preventive and corrective actions for keeping this service up and running. So preventive actions are like the preventive activities, like we do it normally. So even when actually we are working in our office, we have these preventive maintenance activities for our desktops, laptops, even the servers, the ACs and all. So these are the preventive activities. So these activities are done to ensure that the services or these service components don't fail. And the corrective actions are whenever there is any kind of disruption, whatever actions that are required to restore that, that is the corrective action. And important part of this entire activity is training for the response team. So in case if there is any kind of a failure, you just don't have to wait for, you don't need to wait for somebody to tell you to do that. A response team is a team which will take up the responsibility and perform whatever is required for restoring that service. So the response team has to be trained. So that training has to happen, because whenever the situation happens, we will not have time to think over it and do anything. Then you have to plan for the service sustenance. Okay, the inventory which is required for the service sustenance is in case of you have got a power supply as one important component of your service. And if that power supply is having a backup strategy as a genset, you need to have the inventory required for running that genset also. So typically for a genset, the fuel is necessary. So if you have got a genset as a strategy for backup of your power supply, and you don't have the fuel required for running that genset, or you don't have enough fuel for running that genset, then that strategy is going to fail. So you need to have some level of inventory also maintained for the service sustenance. And most importantly, you need to have the monitoring objectives. So there are some monitoring activities which are happening on the manual basis, and there are some activities which are done through automation. Like there are some monitoring devices, or there are some monitoring softwares or applications which are available, which will give you the warning, or it will give you some kind of indication as to what is happening. Like there are some monitoring devices available in our cars also. So those who are having their own vehicles, cars especially, the cars have got the heat indicator. So this is a monitoring device which is being fit into your car. So this will tell you that the car engine has got heated beyond a point, and that will give you an indication that it may result into a kind of a failure or even a further damage also for that car. So these monitoring objectives have to be set. Some of the cases, the monitoring cannot be done through these automated devices. So there you need to have a manual monitoring activities planned for that as well. And then the last two stages are about plan for the recovery objectives and the actual deployment. So what do you mean by plan for the recovery objectives? So here the recovery is how to restore or how to bring it back. So you need to plan for that for each and every situation that you have identified. So for each component, each service component, for each situation, you need to plan for that. And how quickly should it be available? In case, for example, if there is a power failure, how soon should it be restored? Should it be with no time loss, or within 1 minute, or within 1 hour, or within 1 day, whatever may be the target that you may have. So you need to set those business objectives. And you need to plan for the multiple levels of fail-safe mechanisms for the critical service component. So when actually I planned for this session, I have got this internet connectivity through the office internet, which is available. The second level is I have got my mobile also ready with its data available, just in case if the office network fails, internet fails. And I have got a data dongle also, a Wi-Fi dongle, which will work as a backup, second level of backup if the first two fails. So you need to plan for the multiple level of fail-safe mechanisms for the critical service components. So for me to deliver this session, I have planned at three levels. One is, in fact, actually I have got two backups for that. One is the main internet and the two alternative options. And there should be a time also which should be set for the recovery of each strategy. And the last is the deployment. So what do you mean by deployment here is you need to deploy whatever is the plan strategy. So plan strategy is whatever the budget and the training and everything, whatever you have planned for, it should be implemented. And when it is implemented, you have to keep on monitoring it. So if you have implemented it, you have to make sure that it is going to work. It has to be monitored. So whatever strategy that you have implemented, you have to keep on monitoring it, whether it is effective or not effective. Identify and report the failure to the concerned. If whatever strategy that you have implemented, if that doesn't work, then you have to identify and the report has to be generated for why it has failed. And whenever there is any disaster, so the disaster recovery has to be implemented. And first thing which needs to be done is the recovery of the service. And after that, you have to perform the root cause analysis. So you have to perform the root cause analysis, identify why this has not worked, and replan for the service continuity on the basis of root cause analysis. So whatever is the failure, that will get completed. That would get root cause analysis would get action. So there are some things which are to be done in case of unanticipated situations. So what happens is that whenever there is any, in spite of all these service strategy that you have implemented, there is a possibility that there would be an unanticipated situation. So what is an unanticipated situation? Unanticipated situation is that I have planned for everything for my internet connectivity. But unanticipated situation is that my laptop charger is not functioning. At the last minute, actually, it is having some issue. So that is an unanticipated situation. Or all my strategies which I have implemented, my office internet, my mobile internet, and my Wi-Fi dongle, all of them fail. So what do you do? So in such situations, you need to still go ahead and identify what are the critical services and components which have got impacted. Analyze the impact of the situation on the critical services. In that also, you cannot try and restore everything. So here, what you have to do is that you have to work on identify the critical services in this disaster situation and its components, which needs to be restored. You have to try and isolate that impact to the limited scope so that it will not impact the overall service as such. Then you have to plan for how you have to restore these components. So here you don't have to directly start acting on it. You have to identify these things. You have to do the impact analysis, identify where it is happening, and plan for the actions of restoration. Because what may happen is that in a panic situation, you may actually do something which will further impact the service or the functioning of that service. So you need to identify it, plan it in a right way, and plan for the restoration. So these situations may happen once in a while, but whenever it happens, you still need to have some kind of an action plan identified. Gather the resources required for the restoration and implement the restoration plan. Once the restoration plan is implemented, you have to study and record the restoration strategy for further use. Then you have to, then this learning, whatever you have got from this unanticipated situation, you have to use that as a learning for your further service continuity planning so that there is no further service discontinuity because of this kind of a situation. So this is a learning that you need to gather from this scenario. So this is what actually I have planned for today. So this is what I have planned for today. And let me see what all questions are there, and I would like to take these questions now. I would request all the participants who have been very keenly listening to all these inputs, if they have got any queries or questions, to please raise it now. Okay, just a minute. I'm going through with these questions. Actually, there is one question from Mr. Okay, so there is one question about RTO and RPO. So I'm not very sure about what do you mean by RTO and RPO. If you can please specify the full form of that, I would be happy to answer that. Okay. Okay, yeah, so it is recovery time objective. Yeah, right, recovery time objective, recovery time objective and recovery point objective. Okay, yeah, right. So yeah, what was the question? Should there be RTO or recommend for critical services? Yes, so recovery time objective and recovery point objective, this can be planned in such a way that whenever you identify, so when you go for a very basic level planning, what you do is you first identify that what is more important for your business. Okay, so you identify those services which are very important for running your business. And from that, you have to identify that what all are the components which are required, which may actually impact your service. And for each of these service component, you can actually identify that what are the kind of vulnerabilities and threats which may impact it. And on the basis of that, you need to set up a strategy for that. So first, when you apply a strategy, that time you have to set a recovery time objective. So whenever you are planning for that, you have to implement that strategy. You have to train the people and you have to do some kind of mock activity. So when you say a mock activity, that time you have to simulate that situation and you have to try and recover that component or that service. And on the basis of that, you can set a target for that. So once you have set the target, then you try to keep on improving on that target. I hope I have answered your question. There are a few other questions, but actually they would need a lot of technical elaboration, and I don't want this session to be too technical. So what I would do is that those who have raised questions or queries, I would request them to hold on. I would do one thing is that I will try to answer these questions offline through emails. So as you can see that I have shared the details of my contact here. The email ID and Skype ID are preferable. So you please write your questions to me. And try to give some details about what kind of scenario that they have in their organization or for their clients. And accordingly, what I can do is that I can respond to these queries. So that would be an ideal way to go ahead with this. I have got a good amount of questions which are being asked, so I'm very happy about it. So I'm very very happy that so many participants have joined this session today, and so many participants have raised so many queries about different topics. I would like to thank all of you on behalf of QNX, and thank you guys for joining. Okay, So that is all for today. Thank you very much. Bye.